Thank you. The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 14436 in the name of Stuart McMillan on regulation of the medical aesthetics industry in Scotland. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak button, and I call on Stuart McMillan to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, I'm pleased to be leading this evening's members' debate on the need for non-surgical medical aesthetics to be regulated, as it's very much as a topic that I've been highlighting for several years, and I know colleagues from across the chamber have done also. I do want to thank colleagues from across the chamber who have supported the motion to allow this to be debated. The issues surround the lack of regulation combined with greater access to non-surgical medical cosmetic procedure was first raised with me by a constituent, Jill Best, in 2018. I'm therefore delighted to welcome Jill and some of her colleagues to the gallery this afternoon, so thank you. This is about making the industry as safe as possible for patients. Now, it could be argued that, just like any other purchase, people should consider the quality of the product and the person selling or administering it. This is especially true when considering treatments which involve needles and substances being injected into skin. Yet, understandably, people expect lay injectors to be properly trained and provide safe, regulated treatments, but that is not always the case. Without regulation, if a procedure goes wrong, there is little way of holding that lay injector accountable, and the NHS is left to foot the bill for any corrective treatments. In contrast, if a patient goes to a healthcare professional for the same treatment, they are regulated by Healthcare Improvement Scotland. That means that they are regulated prescribers and have sourced medicines from a reputable source. Now, furthermore, they must have safeguards in place to ensure the environment they are administering these treatments in meets health and safety requirements and have policies in place if a treatment does not go to plan. Plus, a healthcare professional can rely upon their medical training to make sure a patient is looking for the right type of treatment following an initial consultation with the patient. Healthcare professionals are also trained to identify if someone is displaying signs of capacity or mental health issues before making a final decision to carry out any procedure on a patient. Now, if they do turn someone away based on these grounds, the worry and concern is that the patient may just go elsewhere and seek out a lay injector to have the treatment done. Now, Presiding Officer, this is only a brief synopsis of the huge range of issues that have been brought to my attention, and also, no doubt, I'm sure colleagues from across the chamber. But it's clear to me that regulation of this whole sector is non-negotiable. I'm therefore pleased that the Scottish Government are looking at bringing in additional regulation. And while I know it has taken longer than anyone would have liked, it's important that we do get this right. As I've learned over these recent years, not just when you think that you've actually exhausted all the types of procedures available, another one comes onto the market. Now, that shows how adaptable the industry is. So we need to ensure that regulation is robust, whilst also being flexible enough to cover any new treatments that become available. Who knows what it's going to be like in 5 years' time, in 10 years' time. So I also appreciate that ministers will want to consult the UK Government to try to align any policy changes with them as far as possible to try to reduce the likelihood of people in Scotland travelling to other parts of the UK for these treatments. Now, that being said, Scotland has the opportunity to lead the way on this issue. Now, the upcoming public consultation will enable members of the public to have a say on potential regulation, as well as healthcare professionals and also lay injectors. It's important that the lay injectors are part of this process too, and have the chance to feed in to any changes that actually are going to affect them. This industry isn't going away. It's not going anywhere anytime soon. So societal demands show that this is very much an industry that is here to stay. So let's make it as safe as possible for everyone. To me, that is the important thing. Now, if regulation drives up the cost of procedures, as I'm aware of how lay injectors are undercutting the prices being offered by healthcare professionals, then that will also act as a barrier to make people think twice about getting a treatment done. It's also not just about the price, because the marketing of these products plays a factor in how people actually access them. I've had dialogue with the Advertising Standards Authority on this very point, and I've seen social media posts where lay injectors offer treatments for free or at a discounted price, as they need models. Now, I fear that this leads people into thinking that these treatments are as simple as getting makeup done, which can be removed. However, if a medical aesthetic treatment goes wrong or the patient doesn't like it, the after effects can't so easily be reversed. Now, furthermore, I've seen some lay injectors run online raffles with procedures as a prize, which is very much at odds with the approach taken by healthcare professionals who consult with patients before agreeing to offer any procedure. Now, these examples I've just touched upon breach advertising rules, and the ASA has told me that in the last 2 years alone, they proactively have more than 50,000 online posts for prescription-only medicines taken down. Now, evidently, Presiding Officer, there are a whole range of policy decisions that need to be considered to deliver effective regulation of the medical aesthetics industry. I will continue to highlight these and engage with the Scottish Government and also colleagues from across the Chamber, but crucially with healthcare professionals, to ensure that this is very much progressed. I look forward to the new consultation, and I do encourage anyone with an interest in this particular issue to get involved in that consultation when it does go forward. And certainly I would like to think that the Minister could give some information, a bit of an update on that this afternoon. So I think that certainly would help, the professionals, so that they know what's coming, when this is coming, so they can encourage others to actually take part in that consultation too. Fundamentally, we want to ensure that this industry is as safe as possible for everyone, including my own constituents in the Greenock and Inverclyde constituency, but certainly across the country. We can lead the way, and we have got a great opportunity to lead the way on this particular issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McMillan. And we now move to the open debate. I would remind members that speeches of up to 4 minutes, and also I would remind those members who would wish to speak in the debate to ensure that they have, in fact, pressed the request to speak button. And I am confused, but in any event, I shall move on. I call Claire Hockey to be followed by Sharon Dowie. Ms. Hockey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking you for giving me permission to leave Chamber before the end of the debate and put on record my register of interest. I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. And can I congratulate Stuart McMillan on securing this important members' debate? Aesthetic procedures have exploded in popularity in recent years, with many clinics popping up on our high streets, offering services such as dermal fillers and Botox. And while some of these treatments may seem minor, the use of fillers and neurotoxins like Botox are medical procedures that can cause serious harm if performed incorrectly. And I would like to share the words of one of my constituents, Suzanne, who owns Pristine Aesthetics. She's a registered nurse and she runs a regulated clinic in my constituency, and I'm quoting from her here. As nurses, we pay high fees to our regulators, Health Improvement Scotland, and we work tirelessly to give safe, effective care to patients. However, we're constantly undermined by people doing short courses to inject people with cheap products purchased online. There's no deterrent, no safety net, or information on this for the public. As nurses, we have high standards and strict protocols on infection control and safe practice. It takes years to train and mould a nurse with the appropriate skill and ethics. The amount of dangerous practices in this area is utterly frightening. Healthcare professionals like my constituent, Suzanne, must complete extensive education and clinical training before being licensed to perform injections and other procedures. Licensed ethicians who may perform laser treatments, for example, typically complete over 600 hours at an accredited training centre. However, there is currently no legislation in place to stop an unqualified member of the public from purchasing materials online and completing a weekend seminar or online course and promoting themselves as qualified to inject clients, regardless of their actual level of knowledge, skill or experience. Worryingly, a 2021 survey of plastic surgeons reported that 63% of respondents reported seeing patients with complications, damage and disfigurement after receiving treatments from unqualified injectors. My constituents' concerns are reflected in responses to a previous government consultation on the subject, with almost 98% of respondents agreeing that there should be further regulation of the industry to reduce the risk of physical harm, psychological harm and associated costs to the NHS when something goes wrong. As one put it, it's easy to train to deliver these injections. It requires far more expertise to reverse or manage the complications. Anyone who cannot manage their own complications should not be delivering these treatments. One cosmetic doctor interviewed in the press has described what she called a concerning trend amongst teenagers to pursue tweakments, trying to achieve a look that is often completely unrealistic and unattainable, driven by online beauty standards and filtered images. And this also chimes with the Girl Guide's recent Girls' Attitude survey. Over half of girls aged 11 to 21 said that they wish they looked like they do with social media filters. Presiding Officer, again here is effectively what my constituent describes to me as a two-tier system currently in place in Scotland. Health practitioner services, which are regulated by Healthcare Improvement Scotland, must take into account the physical and psychological well-being of the patient or client when considering a course of treatment, including their age. There is currently no ban on under-18s receiving treatments from non-medical prescribers. The Minister for Public Health's announcement that there will be a new public consultation on this topic is an extremely important step forward towards ensuring that these increasingly popular treatments are as safe as possible. New regulations will of course have to be introduced with care and consideration, not least to avoid undue difficulties for reputable small business and to ensure unscrupulous providers are not driven underground. And the consultation and continued work of campaigners to raise awareness of areas of concern in the industry will be key to ensuring that regulation will be as comprehensive and effective as possible. The Scottish Government have stated that they want to ensure these procedures are delivered from hygienic premises by appropriately trained practitioners, applying recognised standards and using regulated products. These are sensible goals and ones which the public should rightly expect to be taken forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hockey. I now call Sharon Dowie to be followed by Colette Stevenson. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and also thank you to Stuart McMillan for bringing forward today's debate on an important issue that is of real concern to many of my constituents. Concerns have been raised by medical practitioners that Scotland's aesthetics regulations are woefully deficient. Every day, vulnerable individuals risk putting their health and their lives in the hands of unqualified lay people offering aesthetic procedures. Doctors, dentists and nurses are heavily regulated by Healthcare Improvement Scotland, the General Medical Council and other bodies to ensure patient safety, medicine management and insurance coverage. However, lay people with no professional oversight or competence are free to perform the same high-risk procedures, often in unsafe and unsanitary environments, with little to no accountability when complications arise. Unqualified and unsupervised individuals are injecting botulinum toxin, or Botox, a prescription-only drug, and dermal fillers into uninformed members of the public with no mandatory insurance or medical oversight. Training courses are unregulated, and some practitioners undergo no formal training at all. There is a Wild West element to many treatments. As the member has noted, there is precious little oversight from any professional body and the consequences can be severe. It is time that Parliament looked at this because these treatments seem to be growing ever more popular by the month, so action must take place now before the situation spirals out of control. People who undergo shoddy treatment often end up with deep physical and psychological scars from the experience, so we cannot allow this to go on. While I understand the desire behind it and I appreciate how popular some of those treatments have become, it is simply not worth the potential risk to mental and physical health. The impact goes beyond the individuals who suffer. As Stuart McMillan had said, subpar regulation is also costing our NHS a fortune in time and resources, as our health service needs to step in at a later stage to help those who suffer from a botched treatment. Sometimes this is correction treatment, other times it can result in increased demand for mental health care. In either case, poor practices and the lack of regulation is contributing to the ongoing lengthy waiting times in the NHS and putting medical practitioners under more pressure. I recently met with Leslie Blair, CEO of the British Association of Beauty Therapy and Cosmetology, BABTAC, who highlighted the lack of regulation and standardisation in non-surgical cosmetic procedures. Unlike medical practitioners, These treatments are often performed by individuals without proper qualifications, leaving consumers unaware of the risks. She also stressed the urgency for regulation, pointing to the tragic case of Alice Webb, who died following a botched procedure. This shows how vital it is to implement proper oversight as soon as possible. BABTAC also noted consumer surveys revealing that many people falsely believe the beauty industry is regulated, which only increases the risks involved. Recently, I had a meeting with the legislation team regarding a bill that would prevent under-18s from receiving these procedures unless advised by a doctor. The legislation already exists in England, and I wonder, in closing, if the Minister can tell us if this would be included in her consultation, and could she provide assurances that the Government will be moving at pace. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I thank the Member for bringing this debate to Parliament. It's an important issue that must be looked at in more detail. I believe Parliament has a duty to act to regulate this industry for the protection of people who may suffer from subpar treatments, and I hope anyone considering a treatment from an unregulated practitioner will think again and exercise caution. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Dowie. I now call Colette Stevenson to be followed by Fozzo Chow. Ms Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Excuse me. I am grateful to Stuart McMillan for securing this debate today, and I wholeheartedly support his motion. The demand for non-surgical aesthetic treatments like Botox, derma fillers and Brazilian butt lifts has surged in recent years. However, too many practitioners are unregulated, and this can lead to botched jobs with horrendous side effects. This is something I've been contacted about by constituents in East Kilbride. Presiding Officer, many aesthetic procedures require injections, and lay injectors who often have no healthcare qualifications are performing medical procedures without being subject to the same professional standards as those in regulated clinics. More and more people are seeking these procedures every year, but the regulation has not kept pace with this growth. So we absolutely need legislation to regulate those operating within the aesthetics industry. Only clinics employing registered healthcare professionals are monitored by Healthcare Improvement Scotland, leaving many providers who don't have relevant formal qualifications operating without sufficient oversight. From recent events in Parliament, MSPs have heard harrowing stories of patients who have suffered both physical and psychological harm from botched treatments, which can lead to infection and disfigurement. The emotional toll for people affected can be huge, and this also places a huge burden on our NHS, as many of these individuals need correctional treatment when things go wrong. The British Association of Aesthetic Plastic Surgeons actually estimated that a botched Brazilian butt lift costs the NHS an average of £15,000. It is not right that the NHS has to pick up the pieces due to unregulated and unqualified people offering aesthetic treatments. And at the heart of all of this is patient safety. At present, patients who get treatment from lay injectors have little comeback when things go wrong. And it's clear that we need regulations, not only to protect the public and the NHS, but to ensure good practitioners can continue to provide safe cosmetic surgery. Along with Stuart McMillan and other colleagues, I recently met with Jenny Minto, the Public Health Minister, to discuss issues with the aesthetics industry. And I welcome the fact that the Scottish Government has consulted on this, with the results showing that the public overwhelmingly supports tighter regulation. I also note that the Government is moving this forward with key stakeholders, including healthcare professionals and beauty industry representatives, and that there will be further opportunities for the public to feed in later this year. The proposals should include strict requirements that only qualified healthcare professionals can administer Botox, derma fillers and similar treatments. Patients must be able to trust that those holding the needle have the necessary training oversight and accountability. In concluding, Presiding Officer, I want to highlight that there are many regulated practitioners offering Botox and fillers safely and successfully. People should check out the credentials of a practice before getting any aesthetic work done. But we as politicians also need to step in terms of regulation. Regulating the medical aesthetic sector is necessary to safeguard the health and well-being of the public. I think members across the chamber will be keen to work together to help develop meaningful legislation, and I hope we'll be able to deliver this in the next couple of years so that we can protect patients and restore trust in this rapidly expanding industry.
Thank you. I now call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Colin Beattie. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I would like to thank you for allowing me to leave the chamber before the debate finishes. I would like to congratulate Stuart McLemillan on bringing this important issue to the chamber. In France, if you wish to complete medical aesthetic treatment, you must be registered on the board of the National Chamber of Physicians. In Belgium, you must be a doctor, and under 18s must have permission for a parent or a guardian to have a treatment. In Poland, you need to qualify in aesthetic medicine. Whereas in Scotland, you can go on Instagram today and be presented with numerous practitioners offering aesthetic treatments, very few showing medical qualifications, and all completing work on very young people. These procedures are far from non-invasive. Lip filler, nose filler, chin filler, and anti-wrinkle filler, all involving injections, Botox into people's faces, with bad consequences for botched treatments. A practitioner not operating in a medically clean site can cause infections, requiring further care from our NHS down the line. They can cause bruising much worse than should be normal for this procedure. Nodules can form due to cheap filler, can cause complication years after the procedure has been completed. In fact, there was a story this year involving 15 women being hospitalized after having beef gelatin injected into them. Yet, despite this risk, the practice of non-surgical procedures only seems to grow in Scotland, particularly after the medical aesthetic treatments were banned from under 18s in England. We are hearing reports of more and more children coming to Scotland for injections. This is deeply concerning, and I join members in calling for these treatments to be limited to those over 18. Most of these procedures are not conducted by medical professionals. It is possible to complete training in just one day. No medical body has oversight of this industry. It is clear we are in a dangerous situation. I join members in welcoming the Scottish Government in launching a consultation on proposal to regulate this sector. But this is long overdue. France, as I mentioned earlier, first legislated in 2009. In 2013, in the UK, the Koch report called for improved regulation of the cosmetic industry. Even the Scottish Government consulted on this in 2020. Respondents were agreed then in that we needed further regulations. We had the result of that 2 years ago. I hope Scottish Government's new consultation will open the door for meaningful progress to be made on this. To many who want to improve their confidence are being left with their mental and physical health worse deteriorating. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call Colin Beattie to be followed by Gillian Mackay. Mr. Beattie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Stuart McMillan for bringing this motion to the Chamber today regarding the lack of regulation in the medical aesthetics industry in Scotland. And I'm speaking today to address this as a matter of growing concern to myself and my constituents. And it's a matter which all too often results in disfigurement and mutilation, mainly of women. This lack of regulation in the medical aesthetics industry is very worrying. It's a rapidly growing sector, with individuals seeking procedures from minimal invasive treatments to major surgical interventions. Worryingly, this demand has been accompanied by an alarming rise in unlicensed practitioners, raising health risks for patients, and the lack of adequate regulations poses significant risks to public health and safety. Bizarrely, only private clinics employing a regulated healthcare professional providing a service are regulated, while some treatments are performed by qualified healthcare professionals such as doctors, dentists and nurses. Others are administered by those with little or no formal medical training. This extraordinary approach leaves too much room for high-risk procedures, which means non-regulated, untrained, unskilled practitioners carrying out cosmetic surgery in unregulated premises, leading too often to significant physical and psychological harm to patients. It alarms me that, for example, anybody in this chamber can take part in an unregulated and often dubious training course and then perform medical procedures in the public. That should serve as a call to action for everybody in this chamber. We need to stop this shambles as soon as possible. Unregulated clinics do not need to follow the same rigorous health and safety processes as do regulated health professionals, which can lead to incidents of use of counterfeit products or even products being shared with different clients, risking the spread of blood-borne diseases such as hepatitis. Whilst this poses a significant health risk to the public, the regulations are also unfair on the regulated businesses who carry out procedures safely. Reaching high standards comes with a cost, whilst other businesses are undercutting the competition by risking their patients' health. Thankfully, for those that have suffered from botched cosmetic surgery, our NHS is there to help them. However, at a time when the health service is already strained, this comes with a cost. Research from SaveFace, a government-approved register of medical aesthetic treatments, found that 96% of patients who had complications post-cosmetic surgery and were then treated by the NHS, 100% of these failed treatments had been carried out by untrained, unskilled staff. The British Association of Aesthetic Plastic Surgeons estimates that a botched Brazilian butt lift cost the NHS an average of £15,000. Recent media reports have highlighted cases of botched procedures that have caused permanent damage to people's faces and bodies. Some individuals have suffered infections, disfigurement, and even life-threatening complications. Yet in many instances, those that are responsible for performing these procedures face few or no consequences due to the lack of clear regulation and accountability in the industry. Other UK nations have already made moves towards regulating the industry. And if we don't follow their lead, we risk patients border hopping to receive cheap and dangerous procedures in Scotland. We can't allow this situation to continue. The safety and well-being of the public should be of paramount importance. And I welcome the Scottish Government's planned consultation and hope that we can act on its recommendations as soon as possible to reduce the risk of harm or before we actually lose lives. We must create a framework that protects both practitioners and patients by ensuring a safe and professional aesthetics industry in Scotland. We need to protect our women and our men from unscrupulous exploitation by unqualified and unregulated practitioners. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Beattie. I call Gillian Mackay, who's joining us remotely, to be followed by Miles Briggs. Ms. Mackay.
Thanks very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And the debate brought forward today by Stuart McMillan is an important one, and I'd like to thank him for raising this issue in the Chamber. The current situation regarding the regulation of the medical aesthetics industry in Scotland is untenable. As of today, there's no laws around who can offer these treatments, yet the number of complaints about botched procedures carried out by people with no medical qualifications or in dangerous environments is on an exponential rise. I, along with others, welcome the recent announcement by the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health that the Scottish Government will launch a consultation later this year to explore explore legislative proposals to regulate the sector, along with its commitment to do so within the current parliamentary session. And while I commend the government for its position, it's vital that this commitment is followed through with robust and swift action. During this debate, though, and in conversations around this issue, I think we should ensure that we never shame or blame those who've sought these procedures. From the 17th of January to the 30th of June 2020, the Scottish Government previously ran a public consultation on the further regulation of non-surgical cosmetic procedures and proposals to introduce a licensing scheme. I'd like to take a moment to highlight what this previous consultation revealed, and the report revealed almost overwhelming support for change. Most respondents believe that non-surgical cosmetic procedures should only be conducted by trained, qualified and regulated healthcare professionals. They also stress the risks of allowing unqualified individuals to perform these procedures, whether physical, psychological or financial, are far too great. In addition to wider members of the public, regulatory bodies and organisations were and continue to call for more oversight, either through stricter regulation and or a comprehensive licensing scheme. The UK Health and Care Act 2022 has introduced enabling powers to establish a licensing scheme for non-surgical cosmetic providers in England. Looking at that experience south of the border, currently only a small number of local authorities in London, Birmingham and Essex operate their own cosmetic licensing schemes, and these vary in the number and types of treatment they cover. But there are things, I think, that we can learn from when designing our own scheme. The regulations created under these powers included two separate licences. The powers prohibit people in England from carrying out specified cosmetic procedures in the course of business unless they hold a personal licence, and using or allowing the use of a premise for the provision of these procedures unless they have a premises licence. The Act also specifies the high-level categories of cosmetic procedure, which will be covered by the licensing scheme. And I do believe we should also set basic standards for training and competencies. The Scottish Government previously committed to work with other UK nations to develop proposals for Scotland, and I strongly believe that it's the right path to follow in order to establish a coherent and robust system at the benefit of the people in Scotland and to learn from the experiences of other jurisdictions. Deputy Presiding Officer, several of my constituents have reached out to me, as others have as well, worried about the situation, asking that it be taken seriously and that something be done in an urgent manner. I hope that today's debate will shed light on some of the dangers and make sure that the government continues to work to introduce regulations and ensure and improve public safety. The evidence is clear: without urgent action, we'll continue to see unnecessary harm and further strain on our public health system. Our ultimate goal should be to ensure that all non-surgical cosmetic procedures carried out in Scotland are delivered from hygienic premises by appropriately trained practitioners, applying recognised standards and using legitimate products. And it's my belief that this can only be done through robust regulation. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. And I now call Miles Briggs. Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by congratulating Stuart McMillan on securing this debate this evening, and welcome his constituent, Jill Best, to the public gallery, along with other campaigners who have joined us in Parliament this evening. In June of this year, I was pleased to host a cross-party roundtable in Parliament, which Stuart McMillan and other members attended, and we were able to then discuss the regulation of invasive cosmetic procedures. And I thank the Minister and her officials for attending that meeting. And that roundtable, I think we heard very clearly and very emotionally, actually, the stories of many people across Scotland who have been impacted, and how this is impacting on their lives, not just in terms of what's happened, but their mental health and actually consistent procedures they need to now undertake. I think Gillian Mackay made a really important point in her contribution, and that is around the motivation to have these treatments, because I certainly know from speaking to constituents, often they become blind to the reality of what they're doing, and actually the fact that what they are receiving, even though in many cases it might be below cost of the actual substances which would be used, really just motivates them to have these treatments. And the social media images which they will have seen, often presenting fantastic results of these procedures by the people advertising them, often presents also that safety net. And as members have mentioned, they believe that there is regulation in place. We are seeing this, as other members have said, completely grow and become out of control. And I do worry about other potential impacts in the future. In the States, for example, we are seeing hangover injection therapy grow, where people are having IV treatments by friends and people. We really need to get ahead of this before it becomes a huge public health emergency in Scotland and across the UK. The last UK Conservative government had affirmed its commitment to improve safety, and since the election I've written to the new Health Secretary, Wes Streeting MP, to ask what plans the Labour government will have to take forward those proposals. But I very much welcome the government's plans around a consultation. And as members across the chamber have said, at present, individuals with minimal training, sometimes only after one day course, sometimes just an online course, are administering prescription medications, including injectable treatments, often with insufficient understandings of the complications involved. Even more concerning, though, is the prevalence of some black market products which we're seeing being used, injecting poisons into people's bodies, and we need to see this as a patient safety concern. Because as we've heard from practitioners and patients at the round table and since, this is rapidly becoming a public health emergency. And those raising these concerns aren't doing it because they want this business. They're doing it because they're picking up the pieces from the impacts of these individuals. And we need to see that addressed. One point which hasn't been raised in the debate today, but something I think increasingly we need to also recognise, is a number of people who are seeking surgical treatments abroad, sometimes for tummy tuck, or medical dental surgery, otherwise known as health tourism. And I know from speaking to NHS professionals, they're seeing significant numbers of patients presenting now in the NHS Scotland who have had these procedures and they have failed, or they've had complications abroad or when they've got home. I would like to ask the Minister if there has been any progress in terms of the recording of these cases. Because I think in many cases we just don't have the data of how widespread this has become and the negative impacts it's having, not only on individuals, but the NHS when they have to pick up the pieces. I hope the government will move forward quickly with the consultation and, more importantly, actions which can be taken forward before at the end of this parliamentary session. And finally, before closing, I'd like to ask the Minister whether or not government can look towards some sort of public health advertising campaign around all the issues which have been raised. It's quite clear that this isn't going to be resolved very quickly. There is action taking place, but I do think we need to start raising more concern at government level, across social media as well, at the implications this is having on people, and try to warn them against using these. And thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. And I would now ask Minister Jenny Minto to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too would like to thank Stuart McMillan for bringing forward this debate and for his continued interest in this very important subject. And I'm also hugely grateful to the very helpful and collaborative contributions from everyone here today. I too would like to welcome Jill Best and the members of the Scottish Medical Aesthetics Safety Group to Parliament today and thank them for their raising of awareness that they have been working on. Colin Beattie raised the clear point of significant risk to public health and safety. And like all the contributions today, I have noticed the substantial increase in the number of businesses offering non-surgical cosmetic procedures such as Botox and derma fillers. As Miles Briggs said, a number of us attended a parliamentary roundtable on non-surgical cosmetics in June, and I'm very grateful to Miles Briggs for hosting that event, which gave us an opportunity to hear a powerful account of one person's experience of a non-surgical cosmetic procedure that went wrong. And I completely agree with Colette Stevenson. It was harrowing. And I think I also concur very much with Miles Briggs' point about the professionals that were attending that meeting, that they were very much coming at it from the perspective of picking up the pieces of work that had gone wrong. Just to touch on the point about Public Health Scotland and the recording of cases that NHS Scotland have had to treat as a result of this work, I've spoken to Public Health Scotland about this, and they're exploring that further. But because it's a worldwide coding issue, we need to understand. So again, we are exploring that. I'm also mindful of the points that Gillian Mackay and Miles Briggs have made regarding people's motivation for seeking these treatments, and my thoughts will always go out to anyone who may have been harmed by a non-surgical cosmetic procedure. As Gillian Mackay said, we should not shame or blame these people. And as Sharon Dowie mentioned only just last week, we learnt of the very tragic death of a young mum of five children in Gloucestershire who passed away less than 24 hours after having undergone a cosmetic procedure. As such, my sympathies are with the family of Alice Webb. Many people who undertake these procedures are very happy with the results, and there are many responsible practitioners in the medical and beauty sectors, as Claire Hawhey has outlined, and have others. We all want these procedures to be delivered safely by experienced and qualified practitioners, but we know that this is not always the case. I'm grateful to the environmental health officers and public health teams in a number of local authorities who've been working within the powers they do have to address unsafe practice, for instance, by serving prohibition notices. We also want to provide, we want to provide a more robust and effective framework to support EHOs, but I also want to provide a framework to support responsible practitioners and give confidence to consumers. We cannot entirely eliminate the risks inherent in these procedures, and some are clearly more risky or carry more serious potential side effects than others, but it is appropriate to mitigate these risks. I want to remind members that the Scottish Government, as others have said, has made progress in this area. In 2016, we introduced a requirement for independent clinics to be registered and inspected by Healthcare Improvement Scotland. And earlier this year, we expanded this by bringing independent services provided by pharmacists and pharmacy technicians into this regulation. These clinics are the location for a number of non-surgical cosmetic procedures, and consumers can now access them confidently that the settings are regulated and inspected by Health Improvement Scotland. However, as Stuart McMillan and others have pointed out, there is no regulation of procedures taking place out with these settings. And I agree this gap in regulation is an issue of huge concern, and the Scottish Government is actively addressing this. Our consultation in 2020 showed overwhelming support for other regulation. However, some of the views that we received on the specific model of licensing we proposed were that it was not sufficient to manage the risk of all types of procedures. That's why, at the very helpful meeting with some of you on the 10th of September, I was happy to confirm that I intend to seek public views on more detailed proposals to further regulate the sector. This will build on the previous consultation and the model we proposed. Work is already underway on this, and we intend to publish before the end of this year. We will ensure that this is as widely publicised as possible, and I hope that colleagues are in the chamber and out with will do all they can to support this public, publicising of this. In addition to the consultation, my officials continue to work with the Scottish Cosmetic Interventions Expert Group and engage with a range of stakeholders about what regulation might look like. These stakeholders include healthcare professionals, hair and beauty industry representatives, colleges, environmental health officers and Healthcare Improvement Scotland. The consultation we bring forward will be informed by the views of these stakeholders, who have offered valuable advice on the types of procedure being carried out, the risks they carry and the different ways of managing those risks or making procedures safely. I'd also like to specifically address Faisal Chowdhury's point about age limits in particular. I know that there is an active debate about the appropriate age for procedures to be carried out, and it appears that there's strong support for a minimum age limit for clients. I would like to assure Parliament that our consultation will seek views on age restrictions for procedures in Scotland, as well as the level of training and qualifications people might need to perform these types of procedures safely. Our ultimate aim is that all non-surgical cosmetic procedures are carried out by appropriately trained practitioners in an appropriate setting, applying recognised standards and using regulated products. As we know, this is a fast-changing sector. Any potential regulation will need to be proportionate, robust and future-proofed to capture any emerging procedures. We're working with key stakeholders to get those details right. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I would like to thank Parliament and members for this opportunity to address this debate and commit to continuing to engage with members across the Chamber to ensure we get this right. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.